at 80, when you look at your life, and there are people on all sides of the political spectrum admire the way you live life, from all the things we've talked about, sailing, music, writing, and the civility of it.
I love the way, every time you mention music.
No, I just... I know, it's...
skiing.
or skiing. Tell me about lessons that you have learned. I mean, that when you think about this extraordinary life of the mind, extraordinary sense of living life well, what principles have guided you? I'm not talking about politics now. I am talking about the well-lived life.
Well, I have never been satisfied to be idle, so that when I work, I'm not doing something extraordinary. I'm just doing something that comes naturally.
Yeah.
So therefore, I don't expect commendation for it. On the other hand, I do feel the strain of exertions. The absolute most dismal hour of my life is when I do exercises. And I punish myself by signing up to do them 3 times a week from now on. Now that I truly
that's a reduction
that.
Or an increase?
It's increase. Oh. Yeah. So I think that nature goes after you and castigates you for any tendency to self-satisfaction. So the answer is yes. I do exert myself only by creating prose.
Any regrets about this life that you have lived?
Yeah.
Like what?
Well, I'm not sure I'd tell you. Well, maybe I would. If I could discern them clearly. I had an experience when I was asked to do a fresh introduction to God, Man, and Yale. Yes. On its 25th anniversary.
Right. I remember.
And I started reading, I practically fainted.
Because?
I thought it was so awful.
But you were only 22 or something.
Yeah, but the point is that as you grow older, I think it's true that you become more exacting in respect of your own performances, so that I always regret, if ever I have reason to read something that I have written, that it wasn't better.
Do you wish you were 20?
No, absolutely not. No, I would... If I had a pill which would reduce my age by 25 years, I wouldn't take it.
Why not?
Because I'm tired of life.
Are you really?
Yeah. I really am. I'm utterly prepared to stop living on.
So Bill Buckley left us this morning. He was probably more ready than we were. As much as anyone, I valued him. When I came to the city and started doing this show 16 years ago, I was little known and had not made my mark in life. He came on, and then he sent me a handwritten note with enormous flattery, and I lived with the hope I didn't disappoint his early prophecy. We became friends. Several years ago, when I was sick and came back from near death, he called and wanted to take me to dinner. He wanted me to sail, and I never accepted until one evening he said to me, "I'm not sailing anymore. I'm not doing a lot of the things I used to do anymore. Why don't I ever learn? There is not always tomorrow." I last saw him at Pat's memorial service, and I knew her death was the last crushing disappointment for him. People were walking by as he sat in a chair on the front row after the service. I was last in line, and when I stopped, he looked up, and he saw me, and he started crying. And I said, "I will come see you," thinking there will always be a tomorrow. And now he is gone. There is no tomorrow. But what a life, what a man, and what a friend. We think of the wife he joins and the son he leaves and the rest of the Buckley clan. Good night, Bill. Good night to you.